So let's get started. Kubernetes housekeeping. So one of the big challenges of running large-scale distributed systems like Kubernetes is managing resources. The efficiency and long-term operational readiness of such systems depends on how well the resource utilization is managed and monitored. Kubernetes provides a plethora of mechanisms and options to manage its resources. So let's explore these options today. So before we get into today's topic, let me quickly introduce myself. I'm Damini. I work for Salesforce as a software engineer, and I'm a recent contributor to Kubernetes. And you can find me on Twitter. That's my Twitter handle. And
hello, everyone. My name is Mitesh Jain. I'm open source lead systems engineer doing open source deployments in public and private clouds. And that's my Twitter handle.
So today, we will deep dive into various topics like garbage collector controller, Kubelet garbage collection, and eviction manager. We will also talk about node conditions and how Kubelet reclaims its resources. Garbage collection in Kubernetes. Garbage collection is a process of reclaiming resources by deleting unowned or unused objects. In Kubernetes, there are two different aspects of garbage collection: master level, which is managed by Kube Controller Manager, and node level, which is managed by Kubelet. Garbage collection in Kubernetes at master level is managed by Kube Controller Manager. So what is Kube Controller Manager or Kubernetes Controller Manager? It is a component on the master that runs and manages controllers. Examples of controllers that ship with Kubernetes today are replication controller, namespace controller, endpoints controller, and so on. Garbage collector controller is one such controller which is managed by Kube Controller Manager. The controllers can be configured by options, that is flags, passed on to the Kube Controller Manager. Garbage collector controller is responsible for deleting deployments and its components. It scans for unused and unowned objects based on dependencies and marks them for deletion and deletes them. Garbage collector runs reflectors to watch for changes of managed objects, funnels the results to a dependency graph builder, which builds a graph caching the dependencies among the objects. Triggered by the graph changes, the graph dependency graph builder enqueues objects that can be potentially garbage collected to the attempt to delete queue, and enqueues the objects which needs to be marked as orphaned to attempt to orphan queue. And the garbage collector has workers who consume these two queues and sends requests to the API server to update or delete the objects accordingly. So garbage collector controller can be configured via options passed to the Kube Controller Manager. And these are the set of flags which are specific to garbage collection. Enable garbage collector enables the generic garbage collector, and its default value is set to 2. Concurrent GC syncs is the number of garbage collector workers that are allowed to sync concurrently, and its default value is 20. Terminated pod GC threshold is the terminated pods that can exist before garbage collector starts deleting them. If this value is less than or equal to 0, terminated pod garbage collector is disabled. By default, its value is 12,500. We mentioned earlier that garbage collector controller builds dependency graphs. So these graphs are built using the owner references of the objects. Some Kubernetes objects are owners of the other objects. For example, a replica set is the owner of a set of pods. The owned objects are dependents of the owner objects. Every dependent object has a metadata.owner references field that points to the owning object. Sometimes Kubernetes sets the value of owner reference automatically. For example, when you create a replica set, Kubernetes automatically sets the owner reference field for each of the pod which is under replica set. And Kubernetes also allows users to specially specify the relationships between owners and dependents by manually setting the owner references field. And here's an example showing owner references metadata for an object called PostgreSNS. The object PostgreSNS is owned by the object called PostgreSDB. And pay attention to this particular field, block owner deletion. We will see the significance when we discuss the deletion policies. And this is the dependency representation for our example, previous example. The Postgres DB is the owner or parent, and Postgres NS is the dependent or child. Now this is an example showing multiple owner references. Here, the object Postgres NS is owned by objects, parent objects, Postgres DB and Postgres DB1. And this is the dependency representation for the same example. The Postgres DB and the Postgres DB1 are owners or parents, and the Postgres NS is the dependent or child. Now that we know how dependencies are expressed and how a garbage collector controller builds the dependency graphs, let's see how the controller deletes these objects. Broadly speaking, there are two types of garbage policies for deletion, orphaned and cascading. If an object is deleted without deleting its dependence automatically, the dependents are said to be orphaned. The orphaned objects are cleaned later by the garbage collector workers. A cascading deletion is when the dependents are deleted automatically. Depending on the sequence of deletion, there are two modes of cascading. One, foreground, and second is background. So the cascading policy is set via the propagation policy field on the delete options argument when deleting the object. So I will show how this is done going further. Now this is an example of orphan deletion. In this example, Postgres RC is a replication controller with a pod name Postgres DB. Postgres RC is the owner object and Postgres DB is the child object. Postgres RC is being deleted with a propagation policy set to orphaned. And the owner object Postgres RC is deleted without deleting the Postgres DB, thus making it as an orphan object, and later it is being cleaned by the garbage collector workers. Using the same example, let's delete the Postgres RC with the propagation policy set to foreground. First, the object Postgres RC will enter a deletion in progress state. And in the deletion in progress state, the following things are true. The object is still visible via the REST API. The object's deletion timestamp is set, and the object's metadata.finalizers contains the value foreground deletion. Now, once the deletion in progress state is set, the garbage collector deletes the object's dependents, that is the Postgres DB. Once all the blocking dependents are deleted, the garbage collector will delete the owner object, that is the Postgres RC. Now, a blocking dependent is an object with the block owner deletion field in owner references set to true. Now let's see how background cascading deletion deletes the objects. Postgres RC is being deleted with the propagation policy set to background, as you can see here. Postgres RC is the owner object, is deleted immediately, and the dependents Postgres DB is marked for deletion, which is deleted later by the garbage collector in the background. With that, we complete the garbage collector controller. We will now see how garbage collection works at the node level. As mentioned earlier, node level garbage collection is managed by Kubelet, which performs image garbage collection, container garbage collection, eviction, and reclaims at the node level. So Kubelet, what is Kubelet? Kubelet is a Kubernetes agent which runs on each node in the cluster. And apart from making sure that the containers are running in the pod, it also performs the tasks of monitoring and managing resources on the node. Kubelet reports node status updates to the master at regular intervals so that the scheduler can schedule the pods as per the resources available on the node. Now, Kubernetes provides various Kubelet options to configure garbage collection at the node level. So the command line input options are flags, which are added as kubelet extra args environment variable. Options can also be set in the kubelet file at the path varlib kubelet config. And the third option is dynamic configuration, which was added in 1.11 release. So dynamic configuration allows an admin to define and store configurations as config maps in the API server, which are later fetched by kubelet. The garbage collection related configuration options can be broadly classified into two categories. The first one is trigger or signal configurations, So they define threshold for resources, which will trigger garbage collection for eviction. Policy configuration is the second category. So they define parameters which governs when and how a resource is evicted or managed. Now let's start with image garbage collection. Kubelet performs garbage collection for unused images for every 5 minutes. Kubelet manages images via Image Manager in coordination with the C Advisor. Most of its features are set for deprecation in favor of Eviction Manager. And these are the primary options for setting image garbage collection. The first one is image GC high threshold percent, which is the percentage disk space available on the node at which the Kubelet will start deleting the unused images. And the second flag is image GC low threshold percent, is a percentage disk space available at which it will stop the image deletion. And these are the additional set of flags used by image garbage collection, which will be deprecated and replaced by the Kubelet eviction manager in the future. Now, next is the container garbage collection. So Kubelet performs garbage collection for containers every minute and considers these three flags, min age, max per pod container, and max containers. So min age is the minimum age at which a container can be garbage collected. Max per pod container is the maximum number of dead containers every single pod is allowed to have. Now, max containers is the maximum number of dead containers on the node. Now, these variables can be individually disabled by setting the min age value to 0, and max per pod container and max containers respectively to less than 0. Now, it's also important to know that the containers that are not managed by Kubelet are not subject to container garbage deletion. With that, we enter the very important topic for the day, eviction manager. So,
hello, am I audible? Thank you, Damini. Eviction manager is a subprocess of Kubelet which monitors the system resources and takes actions based on the configured thresholds and policies. Kubelet coordinates with C Advisor for monitoring and managing the lifecycle of images, containers, and system resources. Monitoring or evaluation of resources on the node are performed as per the configured housekeeping interval. The default interval is 10 seconds and can be changed via the housekeeping interval option. Kubelet provides four key policies or types of thresholds: hard evictions, soft evictions, oscillation, and minimum reclaim. If an eviction threshold is met, Kubelet reports node pressure condition to the master so that no new pods are scheduled on the node. We will go in the details of each of these in the subsequent slides. Hard eviction thresholds. A hard eviction threshold has no grace period, and if observed, Kubelet will take immediate action to reclaim the associated starved resource. If a hard eviction threshold is met, Kubelet kills the pod which have been marked to be evicted immediately with no graceful termination. As we can see here, the moment the resource utilization crosses the configured value of 80%, Kubelet reports node pressure and initiates the reclaim process. Hard evictions are defined as a collection of resource thresholds under the eviction-hard flag. In this example here, we have image FS and memory thresholds defined as hard eviction. This will trigger when available disk space on the system falls below 15% of available memory on the system falls below 600 MB. Since these thresholds are defined as eviction hard, Kubelet will immediately start reclaiming the respective resource when they hit the threshold. Soft eviction. A transient spike in resource utilization can trigger and cause the eviction to aggressively evict pods. A soft eviction threshold pairs an eviction threshold with grace period. No action is taken by Kubelet to reclaim the resource associated with the eviction signal until that grace period has expired. As we can see here, the moment the resource utilization crosses the configured threshold of 80%, Kubelet reports node pressure condition. However, it does not start reclaim process. It waits for the grace period to expire before initiating the reclaim process. Soft evictions are defined as collection of resource thresholds under the soft-eviction flag. It pairs these signals with a eviction soft grace period set by the eviction soft grace period flag. Eviction max pod grace period is additional grace period added for during termination of the pods. This graceful termination of a pod allows applications within the pod to drain before being terminated. In this example here, a soft eviction threshold is triggered when the available memory on the system falls below 600 MB. Kubelet will report node pressure condition and will wait for 1 minute 30 seconds before it can start reclaiming the resources. It should be noted that while soft evictions, if no grace period is provided, Kubelet will fail to start. Oscillation of node conditions. Soft eviction threshold could result in a situation where the resource availability on the nodes keep fluctuating around the threshold without ever exceeding the associated grace period. This will cause the corresponding node condition to constantly oscillate between true and false and could result in poor scheduling decisions. As we can see here again in the same example, when the resource utilization crosses the configured threshold of 80%, Kubelet reports node pressure condition but does not start the reclaim process. Before the grace period could expire, the utilization of the resource fell below the configured threshold, so Kubelet now reports that the node is no longer under pressure. In a very short span later, if the utilization again crosses the threshold, Kubelet will report back that the node is under pressure condition, and again, it will not start the reclaim process until the grace period has expired. So we can see here that the node pressure condition is oscillating between true and false without any resources being reclaimed. To protect against node condition oscillations, the eviction pressure transition period flag is provided. It controls how long Kubelet must wait before transitioning the node out of a pressure condition. Kubelet would ensure that the resource that crossed the threshold does not cross it again for the wait period before it will report to the master that the node is not under any pressure condition. Minimum eviction reclaim. In certain scenarios, eviction of pods could result in reclamation of marginal amount of resources just below the configured threshold. Such scenarios can result in Kubelet hitting eviction thresholds in repeated successions. As eviction of resources like disk is time consuming, this will keep the node in constant pressure condition. To address this, Kubelet provides options to configure minimum reclaim with each resource. Whenever Kubelet observes resource pressure, Kubelet attempts to reclaim at least minimum reclaim amount of resource below the configured eviction threshold. As we can see here, when the resource utilization crosses the configured threshold of 80%, Kubelet reports node pressure condition and initiates reclaim process. Without having the minimum eviction reclaim configured, the moment the resource utilization falls below the threshold, Kubelet will report node condition accordingly and it will stop the reclaim process. In this example over here, in the same scenario, Kubelet will not report the node condition until the utilization has fallen by 5% as configured. Minimum reclaim are defined as collection of resource thresholds under the eviction minimum reclaim flag. Okay. In this example, if the available memory on the system falls below 600 MB, Kubelet works to reclaim enough to ensure that the system has at least 600 MB available because we have given a minimum reclaim of 0. The available disk space on the system falls below 10 GB, Kubelet works to reclaim enough so that at least 10 plus 2 GB, that is 12 GB space is available before clearing the node condition. The minimum reclaim helps define thresholds under which the system is considered to have recovered from the pressure condition for the respective resource. The default eviction minimum reclaim for all the resources is 0. When we mentioned earlier about Kubelet reports node status updates to the master, we also talked about node pressure conditions. Default interval for report updates from Kubelet to the master is 10 seconds. This can be changed by using node status update frequency option. One of the two commands can be used to check the condition of a node, kubectl get nodes node name -o json or kubectl describe node name. Kubelet reports various node pressure conditions based on the resource available as per configured threshold. Disk pressure, memory pressure, PID pressure, etc. Disk pressure reports the available disk space and disk pressure reports the available disk space and inodes on the node. Disk pressure will be true if available disk space on inodes or either the node's root file system or image file system has satisfied an eviction threshold. In simple terms, node is running low on disk space. Kubelet supports only two file system partitions, which it auto discovers using cAdvisor. The NodeFS file system that Kubelet uses for volumes, daemon logs, etc. and the ImageFS file system that container runtimes uses for storing images and container writable layers. Kubelet monitors the free space as well as inodes available. Thus, it provides four eviction thresholds: nodefs.available, nodefs.freeinodes, imagefs.available, and imagefs.inodesfree. ImageFS is an optional parameter and it affects how Kubelet will reclaim the resource. We will explain this in the subsequent slides when we discuss reclaim process in details. These are the default values for these signals. These thresholds can be configured as hard or soft eviction as explained earlier. Here are some example configuration. The threshold can be expressed as an absolute number, as in the first example we have used 10 GB, or it can be expressed as a percentage of the resource, as in the second example. This is a snippet of kubectl get out kubectl log. This is the snippet of kubectl get node output showing that the node is under disk pressure. So you see type disk pressure, status true, kubelet has disk pressure. These are log lines logged in kubelet log for disk pressure condition. Here you can see eviction manager is attempting to reclaim storage and providing a list of pods ranked for eviction. Next node condition we are going to see is memory pressure. Memory pressure will be true if the node is running low on memory. Kubelet provides only one eviction threshold for memory, memory.available. It should be noted that Kubelet does not use free command to get the available memory on the system. It computes the available memory by using memory information from /proc/meminfo and cgroup. Default value is less than 100 MB. And these can be configured as hard or soft eviction as explained earlier. In this example, memory condition will be true if the system available memory falls below 600 MB. This is a snippet of the kubectl get node output showing that the node is under memory condition. Type memory pressure, status true, reason kubelet has insufficient memory available. Similarly, these are kubelet log lines for memory condition. We can see that eviction manager is attempting to reclaim memory and provides a list of pods ranked for eviction. If the node experiences a system out of memory event prior to Kubelet being able to reclaim the memory, the node depends on system OM killer to respond. The Kubelet sets an OM score adjunct value for each container based on the quality of the service of the pod defined during deployment. These are the values for the three quality of service of the pod. The intended behavior is that containers with the lowest quality of service that are consuming the largest amount of memory relative to the scheduling request should be killed first in order to reclaim memory. Unlike pod eviction, if a pod container is killed by OOM, it may be restarted by Kubelet based on the restart policy for the pod. Now that we have understood different thresholds and conditions, let us look at how Kubelet responds when a node is under pressure condition. Kubelet will try to reclaim resources in the following order. It will first delete the dead pods and their containers. All images which does not have a running or finished container are deleted next. As a final resort, Kubelet will rank pods based on priority and evict them to reclaim resources. When we discussed this pressure condition, we mentioned that ImageFS threshold are optional and affects how Kubelet reclaims the disk space. With ImageFS thresholds set, If Node.fs thresholds are met, Kubelet will delete dead pods and their containers to free up disk space. And if ImageFS thresholds are met, Kubelet deletes unused images to free up disk space. Without ImageFS, on the other hand, if the ImageFS thresholds are not set and Node.fs thresholds are met, Kubelet deletes dead pods and their containers followed by unused images. Kubelet is unable to reclaim sufficient resources on the node. It begins evicting pods. It first begins by preparing a list of pods to be evicted by their rank. Ranking is performed based on pods' quality of service, priority, and resource usage. Kubelet ranks pods for eviction using following criteria. First, by whether or not their usage of starved resource exceeds their requests. Second, by pods' priority as defined during deployment. And third, by the consumption of the starved resource relative to the pod scheduling request. Higher the consumption, higher the chances of pod getting evicted. Based on these three rules, Kubelet ranks and evicts pods in the following order. The best effort or burstable pods whose usage of starved resource exceeds its request are further ranked by priority and their usage above their request. Guaranteed and burstable pods whose usage is beneath the request are evicted last. They are evicted only in cases when it is important to maintain node's stability and evicted based on the priority, lowest being first. Additional criteria for ranking the pods in case of a disk pressure condition. If disk pressure is caused due to inode starvation, Kubelet evict pods with the lowest quality of service first. If disk pressure is caused due to disk space starvation, Kubelet evict pods with largest disk consumption amongst the lowest quality of service pods first. Again, the option ImageFS plays a role in ranking. With ImageFS threshold set, if a Node.fs is triggering eviction, Kubelet sorts pods based on the usage on Node.fs, that is, local volumes plus log of all of its containers. If ImageFS is triggering evictions, Kubelet sorts pods based on the writable layers of all of its containers. On the other hand, if ImageFS thresholds are not set, if Node.fs is triggering evictions, Kubelet sorts pods based on their total disk usage, that is, local volumes plus logs and writable layers of all of its containers. Now that we have understood the node pressure conditions, let's see how it affects scheduling of the future pods on the node. Scheduler on the master is responsible for selecting nodes to run pods on. If the memory pressure condition is true, scheduler will not schedule any new best effort pods on the node. If the disk pressure condition is true, scheduler will not schedule any new pods to the node. We are at the end now and we'll share some guidelines to follow while configuring the garbage collection options. Instead of using the CLI options, use the config files to configure Kubernetes components and manage them via configuration management systems like Puppet or Chef. You can also use dynamic configuration for Kubelet. Kubernetes is evolving at a rapid pace, so keep an eye on parameters that are marked for deprecation. Reserve resources for system services and Kubelet daemon using the system-reserve and kube-reserve flags respectively. If not set, it will be too late and Kubelet will fail to reclaim sufficient resources as it cannot manage such services. Ensure judicious use of priority and quality of service settings while deploying pods. If all pods are high priority, then there is no priority. If the application running inside the pods require time to drain while stopping, use soft evictions along with grace period. Use minimum eviction and oscillation parameters to prevent aggressive evictions and reclaims. Kubernetes does a very good job of balancing the pods while scheduling. However, it does not perform any balancing post deployments. So keep an eye as evictions may lead to an unbalanced cluster and creating hotspots or underutilized nodes. Finally, plan early. Don't wait till your cluster is already running low on the capacity to begin configuring the settings. And that's how Kubernetes keeps its house clean. Thank you. Any questions? questions, or we are already out of time? Yeah. Correct. To my knowledge, no, I am not aware of any such tool that can generate this config automatically for you. Second, this tuning depends a lot on the workload and the environment. So I'm pretty sure it will be a lot more difficult, because someone running a 100 node cluster and a 1000 node cluster, the settings may be varying a lot. And it also depends on the kind of workload people are running. But like I said, to my knowledge, I'm not aware of any such tool that generates them automatically. Any other questions? Thank you so much for attending our talk.